I'm Carissa Schweitzer, Dowling Catholic and Missouri alum, two-time Olympic qualifier, and this is Empowering the Iowa Girl.
So after the Olympics, is there a little bit of downtime right away, or is this? Are you kind of in a rest period?
Yeah, there's a lot of downtime after the Olympics, just because it's like multiple years of just like working towards like obviously that, and so I feel like everyone just checks out like for a long time, and then come back in.
Good.
It's good mental reset and physical.
So. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Now your family, I think it's fair to say you come from a running family.
Yeah.
And so can you start with your parents? What is their background in running?
Yeah. So they actually, my grandpa is where it starts.
Okay.
So he ran in college at Mankato State. And then my parents both ran at Mankato State. And that's where they met.
And siblings also were involved in running?
Yep. My brother ran at Notre Dame. And then my sister ran at Mizzou as well.
So growing up, was there a time, I mean, did you know right away that I'm a runner, or were there other sports and activities you tried, or did running just come naturally and that's what you went with right away?
I tried all the sports. I wasn't very good at a lot of other sports. I liked soccer a lot. And then I felt like I just basically, like, even my teachers and my family, they were just like, you're just so competitive when you step on the track. Like, that's like, they just saw like another side of me, and they're just like, that's your sport. And I just kind of fell in love with it. And obviously I wanted to do, like, I was excited to participate in the same sport like my parents also participated in, and that's how they met. And so, yeah, just kind of like fell into my lap, kind of. I was really excited about it, and they didn't want to push it too much, because, like, you know, at an early age, if you just like focus in on one sport too much, you kind of get a little burnt out, and they didn't want that to happen for me. So yeah, I definitely played a lot of other sports, but eventually just really loved running. So.
And was running something that in junior high, when junior high activity started, or were you running in some club sports early prior to junior high?
Actually just junior high. That's when it started. So, and even like in high school was still very like relaxed setting for me. Like, I didn't not train like super, super hard. And then college, it was like, okay, now we're definitely like the training load upped a lot. And I feel like that helped me a lot with success in college. And then moving on to a pro level was a whole nother load of training.
And you ran for Dowling. Mm-hmm. And your grandpa was the coach?
No, he actually retired right before.
Okay. And I think I read over 4 decades. He was the cross country coach.
Yeah. So I'm the first grandchild. So he was worried if he coached me that he would have to coach for another like 20 years. So, but he did still, like, I actually call him before every race, and I used him a lot in high school just because I had my coach in high school, but I always just like really valued his opinion. So I was calling him all the time.
Your high school career, I mean, several accolades you have from high school, college, and obviously professionally in the Olympics. But how would you kind of summarize your high school experience with cross country?
I feel like that's just where I really fell in love with the sport. Cross country is just such a team, like, sport, so team aspect. And I just love being able to go out there and like stand on the line with my teammates. And I just felt like that was something that, even when I was looking at colleges to go to, that's what I really wanted. I wanted that team aspect, just because running can be such an individual sport, and it's fun to be able to like come together and really feel like you're taking part of something bigger.
And is there a particular race that you recall from high school that was kind of a turning point where you're like, this is what I really want to do, or just kind of a face some adversity and you're like, wow, from this path forward, I'm a runner?
Yeah, I actually look back at my sophomore year, and cross country was like, I actually won state freshman year in track. So coming to cross country, I was just like, oh, like, I want to win state again. I want to win at cross. And I was ranked really high throughout the whole season and absolutely blew up at state. And it was, I think our team was supposed to win that year too. I think we might have got like second, or I don't know, maybe somewhere in the top five. We didn't win that year. And it was just such a like frustrating experience for me. And I just think, like, in that moment, I just realized how much I truly loved the sport, because I didn't realize, like, you know, when you're like doing well, you just don't realize how, when it's taken away from you, how much you really missed it or really want it. So then the following years, I feel like our whole team and me as well, just kind of like buckled down a little bit more. And like, we're really, the following year when we did win state, it just meant so much more.
Did your coach motivate you differently after that moment? I mean, could he tell that there was something there with that team and with you? That did the practice change? Did his approach to the cross country team and track team change?
I would say it was more, it's pretty similar still, like training and how we went about like everyday practice, but I felt like the team in general just got a lot closer. Like we were all just kind of holding each other accountable for certain things and just like showing up at workouts. We had a hard time in past summers, like all of us going to practices. And so I feel like that was something that was just like a big turning point. And for our coaches, they were just like basically kind of just there and like motivating us, telling us. We had a, like a long history when I came and joined the program of actually, I think they had like 5 state titles in a row. So we were the ones to break that streak. And I think that was a little tough, but obviously just wanted to get back on the podium.
So. Sounds like the culture really changed.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Awesome. The recruiting process. Okay. Well, before we get in the recruiting process, I guess, was there some role models at Dowling? Were there runners or maybe even in the conference that you kind of looked up to when you were a freshman, sophomore that kind of motivated you?
Yeah. I mean, when I was in middle school was when like Katie Flood and Ashley Decker were like good, like firing on all cylinders. Like they were destroying everyone and winning every race. And I think that was just something that I was like, that is so cool, because like not only were they like the best in the state, but they were like going 1-2 all the time by a lot. And I think that was like so cool, just especially like them going to my high school and being like, I want to like be like that. I want to do that. And it's kind of crazy too, because I'm like, I don't think I have any high school records. Like they're all Katie Flood. So yeah, it's pretty wild. And they were pretty fun to watch.
So when the recruiting process starts, did you know right away where you wanted to go, or was there any pressure to go to Mankato State and follow your grandpa and your parents, or did you have a lot of different options? Kind of talk us through that recruiting process.
Yeah. I mean, my parents would have loved me to go to Mankato State, but I think they also knew like I needed to do what was best for me. And they personally were just like, I think there's some bigger schools that are showing interest, and I think you should really look into those. So yeah, I took visits all over. I took a lot of unofficial visits too. And it kind of just came down to Iowa State and University of Missouri. And I really wanted to go to Iowa State, but there was just like a few things at Missouri that I was just like, this just feels like home. And it was just something that like, I felt like if I took away running, if I got injured or something happened, like I still wanted to be there. And I thought that was like really like big realization for me that I was like, okay, I think this is my spot.
And how was that transition from high school to college?
It was tough at times, but I felt like freshman year, I learned a lot, and even sophomore year. And I got really lucky. My coach actually entered at the same time as me. So the coach that recruited me left, and the coach that ended up coaching me all 4 years. I feel like we really like were able to like grow together, and he got to like really know like how I respond to things, like obviously how to like peak me well and stuff like that, and just like respond to like mileage and workouts and stuff throughout the time there.
And several individual titles, NCAA, Division I cross country, I mean the 5,000 meter 2-time champ. I mean, so again, a lot of accolades at college. Is there a race, or is there an event, or can you kind of summarize that experience at college? What's your takeaway from competing at Mizzou?
Oh gosh. Yes, big question. I feel like that just like, well, first off, 2 races that like really have stuck out to me like throughout my whole college career was my first national title was cross country. And I just went into that race not even ranked to be, I think, in the top 5. And I wasn't even on like the pre-race panel for like people to watch for. And I just remember like going into that race being just like frustrated that I wasn't on there, because I felt like I had a good season. I felt like I deserved to like be in that top and like top 5 mix, like people talking about. And my coach just kind of used that as like motivation for me. He was just like, just go out there and prove them wrong, show them that you do belong there. And like, I think just that day, it was just like everything just kind of clicked. And I like can't even recall, like looking back on the race, I can't recall like it being painful or anything. It was just like one of those moments that you're just kind of like, oh, like I'm just like very synced in, very like in tune to the race. And there was a moment where like the lead group pulled away from me and I just like hung on to one person. And then before I knew it, I was like crossing the line and I was in first. And I was literally just like, it's kind of like a pinch me moment. I was like, whoa, like did that just actually happen? And so I think that just helped me like kind of like get to this new level and a new level of like confidence and trusting myself and trusting my abilities. And so throughout my whole time at Mizzou, I was kind of just like learning to like handle that, learning to handle the pressure and just like being able to trust myself and like get to this next level.
How do you as a runner, I mean, when I think of the little 1.1 mile I run in the morning and I'm like, oh my gosh, why am I doing this? Is there, what's your mindset? What's the mantra when you're feeling tired or like in that particular race, things are clicking. Yeah. Is there something that you tell yourself when you're feeling those moments? Is there something down the stretch? How do you get your mindset right to compete at a high level consistently?
Yeah, I feel like I've gone every year. I kind of have a different mantra or a different saying that I use when times like obviously get really tough or if you're falling off or anything like that. And I remember that particular year was kind of just like, you belong. And like, I think that was just something that was really big for me because it felt like before that year, I was just kind of like wanting to be up there, but I wasn't like fully trusting that I should be up there. And so kind of just like repeating that in my head, even if like maybe I wasn't supposed to be up there. I feel like just kind of like finally let it click. And like, I mean, everyone knows like sports, running, all that, the mind plays like a huge role in like your capabilities. And so that was something that I think I kind of ran a little bit out of my fitness level, but it was a moment that like elevated me for the following years or following races.
And did that change your role in the team as a leader? Did you have more confidence coming out of that? Could you see a change in your daily practice?
Yeah, definitely. I feel like our team was just like so strong during that moment. And we actually, as a team, we made nationals. That was the first time in a long time that our team made nationals. And I honestly credit a lot of my like title too, to just having them there, because being with a team, my freshman year, I made it individually. And so when I made it with the team and lining up with all of them, it just felt like so much more just like comforting and just like feel like you're really out there fighting for someone else and like fighting for something bigger. And for me personally, that just helped a ton, like going forward and just like the ins and outs of everyday practice, like being able to just like train with other people and be motivated by other people's successes.
If you could turn back time after graduating high school, what would you tell your high school self about running, about competing? Is there something that after college you're like, man, if I would have done this differently in high school, if I would have had this mantra, could this have made you a different runner in high school?
I actually look back and I just kind of like, I wish I could just tell myself to like relax and have fun because I honestly think I was more nervous in high school for all these races than a lot of the races that I've lined up for now. Like even I look at like Olympic trials or lining up at the Olympics and I'm like, I was more nervous for high school state cross country than I was for any of those moments, which is crazy to think about. But I think you just start to like, obviously I've raced a lot and you start to just line up and realize like, well, I've done all the work, like all the hard part's done. This is the fun part. This is what I love. And I know I'm going to push myself to the absolute max today. Like there's not really anything else I should be nervous for. Like it is what it is.
That's great. It amazes me at cross country. First year I went up there, watched them finish and people just drop and they're dragging them out. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And what blows my mind is they knew they were going to feel that way when they started.
Yeah.
And they still did it. I
mean, you still that's do great. It every
yeah.
time.
Yeah. That's incredible.
Yeah.
So you get to the end of your college career, and at this point, a lot of the people we interview, they're kind of done competing. So how did this transition? Were you applying for jobs, or did you think, you know what, I think I'm going to try to keep running? How did that happen?
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, I didn't set forward in college being like, oh, I'm going to run professionally. So that was just something that kind of developed throughout my last 2 years in college, and you just kind of start getting like these pro coaches starting to like kind of recruit you, kind of like college again. And then like I have an agent too, so it was like a whole nother process and trying to like learn and navigate that world, because That felt very intimidating to me. Was like, okay, I've like felt like I've got the college scene down. Like I know what to expect, all this stuff. But now it's like, okay, now you're taking, and it feels way more individual. Like you're not running for that college team anymore. You're running more for yourself, and you're running for a brand. And I think that was something that luckily I looked like closely at different like groups and teams, and I knew I still wanted to be a part of like a team, and I didn't want to train by myself, and I wanted to be with some people that would like help motivate me and get me to the places I wanted to get, because at that moment I was like, I really want to make Tokyo Olympics. So that was something that I was really working hard towards. And I joined a group where I think it was like 8 Olympians on that team. So I was like, okay, I think this is the like route to get there.
And was that the Bowerman Track Club?
That was the Bowerman Track Club.
So tell us, to somebody who, what is the Bowerman Track Club? How does that, what, how would you describe that organization?
Yeah, it's a Nike sponsored group out in Oregon, and they've just have had a lot of success, a lot of Olympians on that team and a lot of Olympic medalists. So it's something that they have like a big history, and I just wanted to train with a group that was going to help elevate me to that next level.
And so I'm assuming you moved out to Oregon then?
Oregon, been out there for 5+ years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And then do you guys compete around the United States, or does Bowerman Track Club primarily compete in Oregon, or do you travel around the world with that group?
Travel around the world with the group and alone too. So yeah, there's a lot of like, it's very team focused, but then also like there's a lot of individual stuff that like when it gets down to like the end of the season, and we're train a lot, we race a lot in Europe, we train at altitude a lot. So a lot of living out of a suitcase. Yeah.
So your passport looks a little bit different than mine, probably.
Probably.
Now, the same thing with, if you could go back and tell your high school self, what did you learn competing, building up to the Olympics? We're not there yet, but what did you learn those first couple of years with Bowerman that you wish you would have known in college about running?
I feel like learning to celebrate, like, and like truly be happy for other people's successes, because that was something that like that team did really well at Bowerman, really did. And it was something that was so fun that you just kind of start to realize that like you can't, and this is a team full of like I said, like Olympians, American record holders, like everyone's like a stud. So you get humbled very quickly. And it was cool to just be like, kind of like start to realize that like everyone, there's going to be a day where like, it's not your race, but it's someone else's moment, and you want to just like be there for them and celebrate that, because when it is your moment and you have a whole team behind you celebrating you, is just like so exciting, and you just want to be like excited for that, and just builds the group's momentum.
So 2020 Tokyo and 2024 Paris. And again, we could probably spend a half hour talking about both of these, but leading up to the first, what is that? Is it a year out? Is it 6 months out? When does that really focus on qualifying for the Olympics in Tokyo?
Yeah. I mean, Tokyo is different just because it started in 2019. And then in 2020, I felt like I was really ready for it, and then got delayed. So then it was just kind of like, okay, now we have to do a whole nother focus. But I actually trained really hard in 2020 throughout the summer and into the fall, because in the fall it was like, okay, now we're gearing up again for hopefully the Olympics. Cause at that point it was kind of like, it's postponed, but you kind of like, we're still hesitant if it was going to happen. But we trained like it was. And I think just like, I was just so nervous heading into the 2021 trials, because I just was like, wow, I've trained for like 5 years for this moment. Just cause like, you know, the delay just felt like it's been so long. And prior to that, I've never even raced in the Olympic trials. So here I was in 21 being like, I want a spot on that team, but not even having the experience of racing in the trials. But it was strange. It was just like, as the race, like that day actually came around, I think like all like the nerves leading into it and me just like preparing for it, I was just like, I'm going to be so nervous this day. Like, I don't even want to think about it. And then like when the day happened, I just wasn't as nervous as I thought I was. I just kind of like a wave of just like kind of like confidence and like realizing like this is like where I'm at right now, and just like being excited to be there.
In college, that first big race you talked about, you belong, was your mantra.
Mm-hmm.
When you were running to qualify Olympics, what was your mantra? What was your mindset?
Yeah, event? I mean, I have a tough coach, and he was kind of just like, yeah, like, you're ready to make that team, you're gonna make that team. And it was never like a, oh, like, that'd be great, or maybe we do make it. It was just like, you've been training like it, so you better go out and make that team. And I think that was kind of good though, because it kind of took away from like the hesitations of it, and it just kind of was like just like a ton of confidence in myself, in my ability, and my training.
You had referenced that you'd always call your grandpa before your race. Mm-hmm. What advice, what confidence did your grandpa give you? What is it that, what would your grandpa tell you that was the conversation you wanted to have before you run?
Yeah. he's told me a lot of different things. I feel like with him, a lot of the times it's more just like reassuring myself. Like, he just has so much confidence in my ability. He would tell me like, you're going to run this time and you're going to win this race. And even if he was like wrong, I felt like just like hearing him say that, just someone that has been a part of my journey for so long and someone that has been with me for a very long time, inspiring me to get into running. It was just like, it's just, you need someone in your corner that has that like more confidence in yourself than you do. And I'll get you to that point too.
And then tell us about Tokyo. So now you get there, you make the Olympics, and this is coming out of COVID, restricted seating and everything, I believe, at the Olympics.
There's actually no fans allowed.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what two events did you compete in, and how was that first Olympic experience?
I competed in the 5K and the 10K. And I mean, the Olympics experience itself was crazy. I've never been to the Olympics before, but it was also like COVID time. So I knew in my head that it wasn't the same as normal years, but it was just so exciting to like be a part of that. I was just so grateful that they were still able to have the Olympics and able to host. And I mean, Tokyo did a great job of hosting the Olympics. It still felt like very much like the Olympics, and without fans, which was crazy. But I was also pretty injured during that time, so that kind of hurt the experience a little bit for me personally, just because running through an injury is just never fun, and it's hard to like line up and be your best self when you know like you're not 100%. So,
and so Tokyo wraps up, and again, price downtime, get healed up mentally, physically. Did you set your goal right away for 2024, or was there a time where you're kind of reevaluating your career?
I left very inspired. Sure. I was like, there's just so many athletes there, and it was just so cool to like not just track athletes, but like all these other sports, and everyone was just at the top of their game. And it was just like so inspiring to be like, I want to be back, and I want to show up. I want to show up in a better spot than I did this time. And I want to like prove to myself, prove to others that like I belong there. And so, yeah, I felt very inspired leaving after Tokyo, and it was only a short turnaround of 3 years. So it kind of felt like, didn't feel like very intimidating in a sort of like training aspect.
And so now you qualify for 2024, and I got a feeling you're probably a little bit more confident coming into that qualifying race than you were previously.
Definitely.
So what's this experience like? What events do you compete in 2024, which is relatively recently?
Mm-hmm.
How was that experience in comparison to Tokyo and just kind of overall?
Yeah, I mean, it was incredible. My whole goal was I wanted to make it. I wanted my family to be out there. It was really hard in Tokyo just not having my support system and having them. They had watch parties everywhere, but it was just so hard being so far away and not even remotely close to the same time zone. So talking to them was tough throughout Tokyo too. So the whole time just gearing up for Paris, I was like, I really want to make that team. And when that happened, and when I was in Paris, it was just like so many of my family, so many people that have been there for me for so long, like actually made the trip out there. And that was just such a cool experience to be able to show them like what I experienced in Tokyo, because it felt like I never really got, like, I told them about it, but they never really got to experience that as well. So, and they had a blast out there, and they're watching all the other sports, and yeah. And then even stepping into the stadium, like, I think there's like 70,000 people, and I've never competed in a stadium that full before, just with like COVID and all this stuff. So yeah, that was, it was pretty incredible, stadium and experience.
And just the amount of athletes that are there. And I'm sure through Bowerman, you've probably met a lot of them here and there, but the Olympics, the biggest stage, the stadium's packed, that's got to be just kind of a aha moment.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there is just so many people that were just very inspiring throughout the Olympics. It was fun to like watch other people's stories. Like everyone just had a unique experience of how they got there, and being in the village, getting to interact with other athletes was really cool. My family kept being like, try to find this person or that person. I'm like, no, I'm not gonna go search for that person. But yeah, it was fun.
And did you know that you were getting a lot of love from Iowa?
Yes.
So can you, how did you, Dowling, I mean, the state in itself, I know here in our office, Madison was keeping us up to date and we're watching the race, but how much did that mean having that support back home?
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome just like being so far away and getting to compete at like a big stage like that. You just want to like represent the places that like got you there really well, like especially like Iowa. Like think back to my time in high school. I think back to Missouri, right, my college. So there's like all these places that are just like following closely along. It's really cool to see. And my high school, like I think there's just multiple times where they had like watch parties and stuff. So yeah, it's been really fun.
And the mindset again, what were you thinking in 2024? What was your mindset as you're competing in the last Olympics?
My biggest thing, just because I was injured in the last one, was I just really wanted to be healthy at this Olympics. And I can say that I was, which was such a different experience just because I was towing the line with the best women in the world. And I just like knew that I was ready to compete. And I just wanted to go out there and compete. I didn't want to worry about anything else, stress about anything else. And that was the main focus, was just to be really competitive and maximize whatever place I could get.
So now 2024 is done. What does the future look like for you? What's your goals coming out of this Olympics? The career of a professional track runner, I mean, where's your mind now?
I didn't really know because I was so focused on 2024. And it was kind of similar to Tokyo in a sense. I just left like really inspired again. I didn't think that would happen again, but it was kind of just like in Paris, it was just like full stadium, all these people cheering. But then it was like anytime a French athlete was competing, like people would just go crazy. Like the stadium would be chanting their name. Like it was just like really fun, like fun to see and cool to be a part of. Like there was one of my races had a French athlete, and it was just like even lining up on the start line, it's just like they're all yelling her name. Like it's like very awesome. And I just left being like, okay, I want to go to LA. I was like, I want to make LA 2020. I want to have that experience as well, because that was just really cool to see.
That's great. And that'll be here before you know it.
Yeah, I know.
It's crazy. A couple more questions for you here. You've talked a little bit about some adversity you face in terms of some injuries. But what's your advice to that student athlete? What's your advice to that Iowa girl that when they're faced with an injury, how do you work through that? How did you handle adversity?
I think even just leading in before the injury is just kind of like having patience and just realizing, like, I think there's so many times you get in that mindset of like, there's this like one workout I need to hit and that's going to be the one that like gets me to state, or that's the one that I'm going to like get to nationals, like all this stuff. But if you're like hurt or like it's not on the timeline for yourself, like it's not worth it. I think it's like really good to have that sense of just being like, okay, like I know my body, I know myself, and like you can't force anything. And there's a lot of times where I found myself like forcing through some things and then getting injured and going through injury too. Like I think that's really important, like after you have that injury, is having patience just like with coming back and making sure you're ready and getting back to like full health again. And mentally it can be really challenging too, coming back from an injury, and just having like grace with yourself. And personally, like when I come back from injury, I just look at like every week and trying to see like the progress that I make week to week, mm-hmm. instead of just looking at like where I want to be. Like it's kind of like when you're looking at like the top of the stands, like you can't be doing that when you're at the bottom. So I think that's really important to just like slowly climb and have patience with yourself.
It sounds like there's definitely a maturity as an athlete. I mean, from college to professional to the Olympics, that you kind of learn about yourself and how to handle those various mm-hmm. situations. We talk a lot here about the Iowa girl. I am an Iowa girl. What does it mean to be an Iowa girl?
Yeah, I mean, it just means a lot to me, just like to be able to represent Iowa and to have gone through the system like that. I've competed at a lot of state championships here, and like I just think mostly back to cross country and mostly back to like that team aspect, because those are the moments that I remember the most and cherish the most with my high school experience, and friends that like I still talk to this day that I'm very close with. I just think you like build a lot of relationships throughout that. Accountability is showing up for yourself and showing up for others. That means just like the early morning practices, the doubles, the cross training, the workouts that you just don't really want to do, and continuing to show up for yourself and showing up for your teammates, because I think that's when you line up to a championship race or a big stage. Those are the moments that you think of, and those are all like the moments that get you to that point. Communication is being aware of your surroundings and also just like being aware of those around you. I think it's really important as a leader to showcase that too, not just to speak it. Obviously, it's easy to like tell people and like showcase your leading like that, but also to demonstrate it by action is really important, and follow up with that communication style. Leadership is not only leading in practice and leading in races and it's just leading in everyday life, like even just outside of the track or outside of the court, and showcasing yourself as a leader and someone that people want to follow and some that people look up to. Parents are guidance. I think it's important to have those people that are in your corner to go back to if you have concerns or if you're like worried about something, because at the end of the day, it's your career, it's your coach that's helping you, but your parents are just meant to help guide you in that path. Team culture is a big role. It's important for everyone to just really be bought in, and that's something that I've realized in college was the times when we had the best culture was when we had the most success, and that was when everyone was just bought into the program, bought into each other, bought into the coach, and that just really transformed into a lot of success for us that year. Teamwork is just being there for your teammates, but even more than just teammates, but being there for them as like a friend and helping them when times are tough, just because that's gonna like translate really well into the workouts, into the practices, because you're going to get to know your team very well, and then you're just more aware of like when someone else is struggling. And I think that's really important to be aware of, because then you can figure out how to help them along through a practice, which is going to translate to like a race or a competition. Work ethic might be one of the most important topics. Obviously, like from a team perspective, there's a lot of like very important like culture and teamwork, all that stuff. But if you don't have work ethic, you're not going to get any of those places. So I think it's just very important to have like just that discipline and just really just wanting to work hard, because you can't force that on anyone. And you're going to have to get people that like want to show up for those like summer practices and that want to do the early morning practices, because those all just translate into the getting to the championship or winning the state title. And having that work ethic doesn't come alone. It has to come up with other people too, because it's just so hard to like do those things day in, day out by yourself.